गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज़ द सेकेंड चैप्टर ऑफ ज्योग्राफी आफ्टर द डिवेलपमेंट ऑफ रिसोर्सेज. दिस इज़ द फॉरेस्ट एंड वाइल्ड लाइफ रिसोर्सेज. दिस चैप्टर विल नॉट बी इवेल्यूएटेड इन योर मेन बोर्ड एग्जाम, बट एज फार एज द यूनिट एग्जामिनेशन दिस चैप्टर शुड बी कम्प्लीटेड. इट इज़ अ शॉर्ट चैप्टर, इट इज़ नॉट सो मच लेंदी लाइक हिस्ट्री चैप्टर. सो वी आर गोइंग टू मेक नोट्स, discussion and the question answer for forest and wildlife resources, and it is a second chapter of your geography and it is applicable for only unit examination. This chapter will not be evaluated or assessed in the main board exam. So as the name is reflecting, forest and wildlife resources, as you know that forest itself is a resource, and in it you are having the various type of wildlife as flora and fauna. So we are going to discuss the wildlife resources in this chapter, their significance, their importance for the human survival, and how the forest and the wildlife are depleting day by day, what are the measures, how many movements has started in the various part of country for the preserve the wildlife resources and forest in our nation. In states wise also we are going to discuss it. So first of all, like the earlier chapter, you all have to note it down the important terms regarding this chapter. These terms are very much essential so that when it will come in your chapter, the definition and the meaning will be clear to you. So class 10th part 1 geography lesson 2 forest and wildlife resources, important terms. The first is biodiversity. I think that you must be knowing about the biodiversity in your previous classes, as this word is related to your biology also and as far as the geography sector also. So biodiversity, it is a combination of two words. Bio means life and diversity means variety. Where you are having biodiversity means where you are having the variety of lives in it. It is the sum total of all the varieties of plants, animals and microorganisms found within a specified geographical region. It means biodiversity is a region, geographical region, where we are having the different types of flora and fauna. It means plants, animals, microorganisms. These all come to under the biodiversity. Second is habitat. It is natural home of an organism. As if somebody will ask that what is the natural home for Asiatic lions, so the dense forest. The dense forest is all about their habitat. Habitat means natural home of an organism. Next, ecological system. What is ecological system? The interactions of a particular group of organisms with abiotic factors. What are abiotic factors? I have explained you biotic resources and abiotic resources in the previous chapter of geography. Although I have written here also that the interaction of particular group of organism with abiotic factors. Abiotic factors means water, light, radiation, temperature, humidity, atmosphere, acidity and soil. The interaction of particular group of organisms with abiotic factors within a particular habitat, resulting in a clearly defined energy flows and material cycles on land, water and air are called ecological system. It means you are having the land, and you know that there are some animals who are amphibian, who can survive on land as well as in water. Some are marine animal, and the fisheries, these are their habitat is the water or sea or ocean. So these are different types of ecological system. Some are related to the land area, some are water, and some are air. So this system is known as a ecological system. Now the term is flora. It refers to natural vegetation of a particular region. It means if we are saying that flora, so it indicates the vegetation, which include the various type of plants, trees, herbs, is come under the flora. The region where you are having different variety of vegetation is known as flora. Next is fauna. fauna, it refers to all animals living in a particular region. When we are saying fauna, it means we are talking about in a particular region, we are talking about all types of variety of animals that indicate with the one term, and it is fauna. Next, forest, very easy. That it is an extensive area covered by trees. You cannot say that if you are having in an area you are having 20 or 30 trees, it doesn't come under the forest area. Forest, when you are when you are signifying one place with the term forest, it means an extensive area covered by trees. Then normal species. Now we are talking about the fauna, that how many species we are having. So normal species, we categorize them into normal species, endangered species, then vulnerable species. Now first is normal species. What are normal species? Species having the normal population level for their existence are considered normal species. It means these are the species which are not in the category of extinction. They are available in the atmosphere and they will remain available in upcoming future also. So these species are known as a normal species. Now the second category, endangered species. This includes those species which are in danger of extinction. It means if we will not preserve them after some year or after some month, these species also will be extinct from the earth, such as black buck, crocodile, Indian rhino, Indian wild ass, Sangai lion tailed, mox, etc. So these are the species which can be, if we will not preserve them, we will not save their lives, then it will be anytime it will be extinct from the earth. Now next category of fauna species, the vulnerable species. This includes species which are likely to be in danger of extinction in near future. Here we are sure that these vulnerable category of species are the animals which are in near future somehow, just because of some reason, it is possible, it is quite sure that they will be extinct. And these included, if the factors threatening to their extinction continuous, it means if we continuously the factor which are responsible for their depletion will remain there in atmosphere, that one day in near future these species will be extinct from the environment. Now survival of these species is not assured as their population has reduced greatly. And if we talk about that, how much they will survive in near future, we can't guess it properly, as so many population is already reduced in a great number. An example of vulnerable species are Gangetic dolphin, blue sheep and Asiatic elephant. These animals are the at the point of vulnerable categories, that if we already we have lost their great number, and if we will not preserve them, then one day there will be no clue of dolphin, Gangetic dolphin, blue sheep and Asiatic elephant. Now next category is rare species, as the name is itself reflecting, which cannot be found easily. Rare species, population of these species is very less in the world. We are talking about worldwide. They are confined to limited areas or thinly scattered over a wider area. Their presence is very less in around the world. And if they are already very less in number, and if we are not preserve them, we will not protect them, then definitely the rare species will be extinct forever. Example of rare species, Himalayan brown bear, Asiatic wild buffalo and hornbill, etc. These are the rare species of animals that if we will not preserve them, then definitely they will be extinct from the earth. Now the another category, this is the sixth category, endemic species. What are the endemic species? Species which are only found in some particular areas, usually isolated by natural or geographical boundaries. Now endemic species of animals are the species which usually found in the isolated area. Isolated where there is no urbanization, there is no population. Isolated place are having the presence of endemic species. Example, Andaman teal, wild pig, Nicobar pigeon, Arunachali mithun, etc. These are the animals which are having the presence in the isolated areas. They are very isolated species that which cannot be found everywhere in the world. Next category, extinct species. The species which are now extinct from our earth, species which are not found even after conducting searches in the areas where they are likely to be found. That is, the scientist and geologist and researcher have already tried a lot to find their next generation, or their, you can say, any type of clue where they will find these extinct species around the world, but there is no, you can say, final result or the good result that they are not having there any type of species or kingdom right now in the world. They are now totally extinct from the world, and these are the pink head duck, Asiatic cheetah, etc. Pink head duck and Asiatic cheetah, once they were available in the dense forest of the world, but now they are not, they are totally extinct from the places. So these are pink head duck and Asiatic cheetah. These two species come under the extinct species. In examination question may be asked that in which category of species pink head duck and Asiatic cheetah is belong to. So any type of question, as in terms of true false, fill ups, very short question, match up, it can be asked by these short terms, or you can say important terms. So that's why these important terms is not only just to note down. These important terms is your preparation for one mark question, for your objective type of question in your main examination. Even unit also you will be having 20 marks objective questions. Objective question means one word answer, fill up, MCQs, true false, yes no, and term based question. So many things can be asked from these, all these important terms and dates. Next, that mangrove. So a tree, what are mangrove trees? A tree that stands on roots which are above the ground. The tree which stands on roots which are above the ground, that their roots are on the above the ground, are known as a mangrove trees. Next, deforestation. I hope that, and I believe that you know the meaning of deforestation and afforestation. These are very common terms nowadays. Deforestation, the process of destroying forest at a large scale, is known as deforestation. Afforestation, the process of planting a large number of trees on bare land. It is important. On bare land is known as afforestation. You are planting a number of trees on bare land. This term is known as afforestation. It doesn't mean that you are planting three or two trees and you are saying that I am doing afforestation. No. The process of planting a large number of trees on bare land is known as afforestation. Now, poaching. What is poaching? An illegal activity of hunting animals for their skin or horns for economic benefit is known as poaching. So, poaching is an illegal activity. Now, the our constitution prohibited to kill the wild animals for their skin, teeth and other benefits. It is a crime now. So poaching, an illegal activity of hunting animals for their skin and horns for economic benefit. Next is reserved forest. Now the category of forest, that there are various category of forest. The among them, the first is reserved forest. What are reserved forest? An area notified under the provision of Indian Forest Act or the State Forest Acts having full degree of protection are known as reserved forest. It means under the Forest Act of State or Indian Forest Act, there are certain of a reserved forest area where nobody can enter without permission. They are fully protected. There is no economic activity can be held there. They are under the control of state government or the Indian Forest Act. In protected forest, all activities are prohibited unless permitted. that you might be knowing that in the forest area that somehow the local people go there to collect the firewood for their livelihood, but in reserved forest no local people can enter to do their basic you can say activity to collect the firewood. Only if the government will allow, then anybody can enter it. That's why all activities are prohibited unless permitted by the government. Next category of forest is protected forest, an area notified under the provisions of Indian Forest Act or State Forest Acts having limited degree of protection. In these forest, all activities are permitted unless prohibited. So, protected forest are again under the control of state government or the Indian Forest Act. Here, all activities can be permitted if there is a requirement. But they are also protected under the Indian Forest Act. If they are giving the permission, then the common activity can be done by the people here. So third category is unclassed forest. First is reserved forest, second protected forest, and the third is unclassed forest. These are the forest and wastelands belonging to both government and private individuals and community. Now here when we are saying unclassed forest, that they come under the government also and the private individual also and the community also. That unclassed forest can be owned by the community, private individual as well as the government. So such type of forest are known as a unclassed forest. Now that we have discussed about the biodiversity, and now there is a general question that what is the importance of biodiversity. If you know that what is biodiversity, I think you can write down the importance and the necessity or the requirement of biodiversity. Biodiversity or biological diversity involves flora and fauna. Flora is included the regions which are intensely rich in variety of vegetation like trees, forests, etc. These forests are the home of or habitat of varied wild animals and birds, etc. There is a independence of this biodiversity, as our daily needs products are made of wood which is brought by trees. Various types of herbs and Ayurvedic medicines, cosmetic, etc. we get from near market, all are the products which are derived from the flora and the various type of vegetation. You can add your own relevant point also. I am just giving you idea that what is the importance of biodiversity, why there is a need to save the flora and fauna in our nation or around the world. This is a general view I am talking about. Now as far as the chapter that we have talked about the biodiversity, now what are the negative factors that causes such fearful depletion of flora and fauna? As we know that nowadays we have talked about in key terms and the important terms that how the flora and fauna, how the species are at the category of extinction. So many species of fauna already extinct, and some are in endangered category, some are in vulnerable category in terms of vegetation also. It means flora and fauna both. So what are the negative factors that are causing of so much rapid depletion of the flora and fauna? If you look around, you will be able to find out how we have transformed nature into resource, obtaining directly and indirectly from the forest and wildlife. Wood, bark, leaves, rubber, medicine, dyes, food, fuel, fodder, manure, etc. These all things we get from the, you can say, these flora and fauna. So it is we ourselves who have depleted our forest and wildlife. The greatest damage inflicted on Indian forest was during the colonial period due to the expansion of the railways, agriculture, commercial and scientific forestry and mining activity. If we trace the history during the colonial period, so during the British rule, our flora and fauna get to depleted in a large amount or in a large number, as they have the Britisher construct the railway platform to expand their you can say economic benefit for agriculture also. Commercial purposes and scientific forestry and mining activity. You know, it was a long process and it has started. The depletion of flora and fauna started for British rules in India. Even after independence, agriculture expansion continues to be one of the major cause of depletion of forest resources. Even after getting the freedom, after the independence of India also, we are again, for our economical benefit, we are again using the, we are cutting the forest for making means of transportation, making roads, bridges and other economical activities. We are cutting down the forest. Between 1951 and 1980, according to the Forest Survey of India, over 26,200 square kilometer of forest area was converted into agricultural land all over India. So you can imagine that why this is happening, that why we are every now and then we are you can say upgrading and increasing the agriculture area, as we are the second largest populous country. It is all about to satisfy every citizen's basic need food, shelter and health. So that's why the government of India are also giving the project, and they are also cutting down the forest area to convert these land forest area into agricultural area. Substantial parts of the tribal belts, especially in the northern, eastern and the central India, have been deforested or degraded by shifting cultivation. And the shifting cultivation, also known as jhum, J-H-U-M, jhum, a type of slash and burn agriculture. Two terms you are knowing here, that jhuming agriculture or slash and burn agriculture. That in our India, the substantial parts of tribal belt, especially in northern, eastern and central India, the area has been deforested or degraded by the shifting cultivation. The people are doing there the shifting agriculture, it means jhuming agriculture, and it is a type of slash and burn agriculture. Slash and burn agriculture, that for some time they produce one crop and after harvesting the crop, they burn the remaining parts of the crop, and then they left the area, and after some month they again start a new crop on the same piece of land. This is known as a slash and burn agriculture. So you can imagine that the northern, eastern, central India part also degraded so much forest area just for increasing the agriculture area, so as it is necessary. Now the one important thing, that the Himalayan yew in trouble. That Himalayan yew is a medicinal plant. It is important that how the species of vegetation are extincting in India, that the Himalayan yew is a medicinal plant found in various parts of Himachal Pradesh and Arunachal Pradesh. A chemical compound called taxol is extracted from the bark, needle, twigs and roots of this tree, and it has been successfully used to treat some cancers. So how important the Himalayan yew, this vegetation, is to be found in Himachal Pradesh and Arunachal Pradesh, and it, whatever chemical we found from its bark, needle, twigs, is used as a treat the cancer patient. The drug is now the biggest selling anti-cancer drug in the world. The species is under great threat due to over-exploitation. As you know that it is commercial purposes to save the cancer patient. So the species is now under great threat due to over-exploitation. As you know that around the world how many cancer patient is increasing and how much percentage of cancer patient we are having. So after knowing this fact that the Himalayan yew twigs, bark and needle having the chemical which can be used to you can say which can be used to as a medicine to treat the cancer patient, so now it is in under threat just because of over exploitation. In the last one decade, thousands of yew trees have dried up in various parts of Himachal Pradesh and Arunachal Pradesh just because of the over exploitation that it is all about. To as I in the earlier chapter we discussed about that we can satisfy anybody's need but we cannot ever satisfy anybody's greed. So when we do over exploitation in our life, then it means we are going to be ruined. So that's why the Himalayan yew is also in a great trouble, that now it can be also at the point of extinction. So it is our duty that how much we have to use the resources so that it will remain for the future generation. Sustainable development is necessary to use each and every source in which is present in our nature. Next, regarding this, we have talked about that how much species has extinct. We have talked about that Himalayan yew also. Now we are talking about the how we can preserve. Conservation of forest and wildlife in India, how we can do it. Conservation in the background of rapid decline in wildlife population and forestry has become essential. But why do we need to conserve our forest and wildlife? Conservation preserves the ecological diversity in our life, support system, water, air, soil. It also preserves the genetic diversity of plants and animals for better growth of species and breeding. For example, in agriculture, we are still dependent on traditional crop variety. Fisheries too are heavily dependent on the maintenance of aquatic biodiversity. In the 1960s and 1970s, conservatives demanded a national wildlife protection program. The Indian Wildlife Protection Act was implemented in 1972. With a various provisions for protecting habitats. In All India list of protected species was also published. The thrust of the program was towards the protecting the remaining population of certain endangered species by banning hunting. They have banned hunting, giving legal protection to their habitats and restricting trade in wildlife. Subsequently, central and many state governments established national parks. Now, these are the measures. National parks and wildlife sanctuaries, about which you have already studied. The central government also announced several projects for protecting specific animals which were gravely threatened, including the tiger, the one-horned rhinoceros, the Kashmir stag, or the hangul. Three types of crocodiles, freshwater crocodile, saltwater crocodile, and the gharial, the Asiatic lion, and the other. Most recently, the Indian elephant, black buck, chinkara, the great Indian bustard, and the snow leopard, etc., have been given full or partial legal protection against hunting and trade throughout India. So it is all about that how we can conserve the, how the government is helping to protect the wildlife sanctuary by the banning hunting, and they have launched the Indian Wildlife Protection Act also in 1972. Under it, they banned the hunting and the wild animal. They have developed the national parks and the wildlife sanctuary in all various states of India to protect the wildlife. And under it, there is one important project, and the Project Tiger. What is all about Project Tiger? What was its aim? Tiger is one of the key wildlife species in the faunal web. In 1973, the authorities realized that the tiger population had dwindled to 1,827 from an estimated 55,000 at the turn of the century. The major threats to tiger population are numerous, such as poaching, it means hunting for trade, shrinking, growing human population, etc. The trade of tiger skins and the use of their bones in traditional medicines, especially in the Asian countries, left the tiger population on the verge of extinction. Since India and Nepal provide habitat to about 2/3 of surviving tiger population in the world, these two nations became prime targets for poaching and illegal trading. Project Tiger. Now we are talking about the Project Tiger, one of the well-published wildlife campaign It was a campaign in the world was launched in 1973. Project Tiger was launched in 1973. Initially, it showed success as tiger population went up to 4,002 in 1985 and 4,334 in 1989. But in 1993, the population of the tiger had dropped to 3,600. There were 39 tiger reserves in India. How many tiger reserves in India? 39 tiger reserves in India, covering an area of 3,2137.14 square kilometer. Tiger conservation has been viewed not only as an effort to save an endangered species, but with equal importance to as a means of preserving biotypes of sizable magnitude. Corbett National Park in Uttarakhand, important. Sundarban National Park in West Bengal. Bandhavgarh National Park in Madhya Pradesh. Sariska Wildlife Sanctuary in Rajasthan, Manas Tiger Reserve in Assam and Periyar Tiger Reserve in Kerala are some of the tiger reserve of India. So you have seen that in a different state how under the Project Tiger, which was launched in 1973, the various states had developed their national park to preserve the tiger species. So it is all about that tiger to save the flora and fauna. The conservation projects are now focusing on biodiversity rather than on a few of its components. There is now a more intensive search for different conservation measures. Increasingly, even insects are being to find place in a conservation planning. In the notification under Wildlife Act of 1980 and 1986, several hundred butterflies. Now the insects also. We are not flora and fauna. It doesn't mean that only animals and vegetation, but the insects are also that they have to be preserved also. That several hundred butterflies, moths, beetles and the dragonfly have been added to the list of protected species. In 1991, for the first time, plants were also added to this list, starting with 6 species. So it is all about of this chapter that we have discussed about the important terms. We have discussed about the factors which are responsible for the depletion of flora and fauna. We the species which are in at the point of extinction is including the Himalayan yew and how the government have launched the Indian Wildlife Protection Act in 1972 for the conservation of wildlife and sanctuary in India, and then Project Tiger, then that insects, and the government is planned not only to save the flora and fauna, but to save the several, you can say, insect life also. That it is all about the conservation of forest and wildlife.